Welcome back to another episode of Lobby Call. This is season three. We're finally back. We got John Curry back with us today. We got Shareef Keys.
Shareef,
there we go. Shareef is an artist, writer, producer, from Brooklyn, from BK.
Yes, sir.
He's worked with people like Ghostface Killah, Mickey Fax, Bun B, etc. But yeah, man, tell us about yourself, Shareef, for the viewers and listeners who don't know.
Like you said, my name is Shareef Keys, coming from BK. I'm a man of many talents. Artist, make music, write music, dance my ass off when I can. You know what I'm saying?
Father.
Yeah. You know,
loving father.
I'm your favorite dad on all social media. If you know what I mean, you're looking for the right guy. I'm the guy to go to when you need a little bit of. How do I wipe my baby, my newborn baby, the right way? I go to him for the advice. You know what I'm saying? And I brought my guys with me too, man. I brought my good friend.
Here we go. Brother, shout him out.
E.
I mean,
King. This guy right here, man. His name is E King, but I call him EU Sick. He's one incredible producer. I'm gonna let him say his stuff, and then I got my other brother over here, co-write some stuff with me as well.
There we
incredible
go.
Artist. But yeah, you take it away.
I go by the name E King, music producer. Been working with Reef for a little while now. How long? A couple years.
Yeah, probably like 2 years.
Working on a bunch of stuff. Got a project coming soon.
When's that drop? And what's the name of the project?
It's called Primetime. Primetime okay. Is a project. It's an EP produced by me. Reef is on all the songs. August. We shooting for August. If the project is not dropping August, definitely the first single is dropping it on August.
You're also on camera, by the way.
Right.
Whatever you think is not on camera, it's on camera.
So they still be picking boogers. I'm trying to get that joint out. Okay. My name is Baghdad Brook, man. Great friends with Shareef, like literally childhood friends. Mm. But we've been working on music for years, even before we was in the studio. But I'm working on a project now called The Sound Chefs Presents Purple Element. I'm an MC, a writer. These two guys, E King and Shareef, they like master engineer.
We go, talk your shit.
You know what I'm saying? They produce like basically all the project, the entire album. That's also going to be dropping soon. We just figuring out like the launch date and stuff. But, we just staying active, man. Out here in L.A. to see the good guys.
There
see homie John. Mm-hmm. Just link up with some great people and lay down some foundation so we can get good music out here to, from New York to L.A.
There we go.
Around the world, you know what I mean?
There we go.
All right, hold on. Let me make sure niggas know this is.
No, we know who you are, John.
This is my cousin.
Oh, though. Oh yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
so for all the viewers and listeners who don't know, this is John Curry's like blood cousin.
This is my cousin. Like, nigga, we was born in the same week. You know what I'm saying? We would have grown up since day one. Our mothers grew up the same way, nigga. Since day one. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
so we out here,
same
nigga.
Face and all that. They
cousin,
brother cousin.
Yeah,
real talk though, real talk. Dude,
really grew up. I just had to throw that in. Yeah.
Colors, there we go. You guys already know who John Curry is. He's been up here like twice already.
Facts.
And he's a recurring guest. Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna ask Shareef some questions just to, so people can get to know you a little bit. Mm-hmm. This is a question that we've asked up here multiple times, but it's I like to hear from new people what their perspective is. What does success mean to you, and like what is success? When it comes to like music and
music,
just
my
or in general, whatever.
Oh, in life, okay. By the way, I'm a huge fan of this podcast. I told him that off air, but I've literally watched every single podcast.
There we go.
And all the ones with my cousin, I watched that joint like three times.
There we go.
Success to me is two different things. I was just talking to my lady about this. One side of success is definitely financial growth, financial freedom, financial gain. I've absolutely done shows to make some money. I've absolutely done records that I'm like, yeah, it's gonna pay some bills, so I might have to do it. So to me, in that aspect, success is absolutely just earning as much as you can from the art that you give to the world. And then the other side of success that I'll be trying to, not trying to, what I'm reaching for is just to get to the greatest beat, the greatest song I ever wrote in my life. You know what I mean? That's success. Getting the people that I admire to say, yo, you're dope. Whether the world knows it or not, we know Quincy Jones said Shareef is dope.
Right.
Pharrell is dope. Timbo's dope. Sego say you dope. My cousin say, yo, I'm going to play this music around people because I genuinely like it. That's success.
Right.
That's getting to the core of really being that good. So it's both of those things for me, really. And okay. Obviously, I'm a dad, so
there we
good
go.
Parent. Good
daddy!
I need to get that sound bite. And being a... and being a... being a good partner, man. You know what I'm saying? If that's the role I'm playing, so... Yeah, all those things.
There you go. John, what you think? Just a retouch of what you said a few episodes ago. Yeah. Like,
I probably feel similar to whatever I said at that point in time. Yeah, man. I'm
like, same.
Yeah, it's similar. You know what I'm saying? I'm not a capitalist per se. Like, in my mindset, you know what I'm saying? I've never been the type of nigga to really chase money. I've been more the type of person to try to chase that passion or try to, like you said, like, be in that situation where, like, the people you admire, the people that's like, yo, you got it. Mm-hmm. Like, you understand what it is. Like, or, you know, they could call you their brother or something like that. You know what I'm saying? That's always kind of been, you know, what I chase. I want to be a drummer's drummer. Mm-hmm. Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, that's
I feel you.
That's always been my thing, so.
Yeah. I mean, I think for me, success when it comes to, like, music, I feel like it's a culmination of, like, both of what you guys said.
Yeah.
And on top of just, like, being able to make a living, like, live really comfortably, whatever your level of,
comfort is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fiscal level of what I'm saying. Fiscal. <Right. Nah>.
Y'all be, I ain't gonna lie, y'all be kicking a lot of big words about it. Keep going. We're going with you, man.
Dictionary. Nah, but just, being able to live comfortably off of your gift and off of your talent and, you know what I'm saying? And just being happy and just, being able, financial freedom is I feel like a staple of just what, success is, as well as all the other things that you guys said too.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? So if you don't have to chase money, you don't have to chase money, but I feel like if you keep doing your passion and what you using your gift, the money will, you won't have to chase it. It'll just naturally come. Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Definitely.
Yeah, man.
I agree.
Yes, sir. Where do you see yourself in 5 to 10 years?
Damn, great question. Yeah. 5 years, I would definitely say I see myself at a way higher level musically. Just like way better writer, way better producer. I think I could write some good stuff when I'm really in a good groove, produce some really good shit when I'm in a good groove.
It's just my mood.
Right, it's just your mood. It's just my mood.
Quick drop.
Right.
Owning a house, you know what I mean? Finding a nice, stable situation as far as, like, the family goes, you know what I'm saying? And 100 million streams, that's the goal, man. 100 million streams,
there we go.
Going for it. Yeah, yeah.
There we go.
Yeah, put it in the sky so, the world can hear it.
Yeah.
Just really get into it, man. This year is about really making sure I do exactly what I set myself out to do. So, just conquering that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What about you, John?
It's similar, you know what I'm saying?
Y'all, I guess what it is, Jammer. Jammer.
Y'all know
this
how
is why
I get
he's my
down,
cousin,
like,
by the way, too. Everything he usually says, I'll be like, oh, yeah, damn, I would have said it damn near verbatim.
But when it comes, musical stuff, like, my musical goal, of course, 5 to 10 years. I hope to have a Grammy, that's a goal of mine, that's just something that's like, as a musician, I want to achieve this. I don't know, man. Mm. I mean, I just, I definitely want to have, like, a family, like, because I think, something, like, really kind of revolutionary about raising kids a certain way,
you
know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, like, I really do want that, and land and all those types of things. Like, I'm on that, I'm on that. Just, like, I'm trying to create a town, like a some, you know, a community, a village. Something, a village, you know, what I'm saying? A village, you know, what I'm saying. I'm really trying to like create something for the future, you know, what I'm saying, for my family or my kids or whatever that is. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think the next 10 years will definitely be like, you know, those will be my 30s. So like,
yeah,
I'm trying to like.
I'm old.
I'm trying to like retire when I'm like 45. Like I had talked to this dude one time.
That's hard.
I was at BET and this dude was like a producer. We was like eating in the calf or whatever mm-hmm. they had the food. And this dude was sitting at a table.
I was there with you. Mm-hmm. Oh no, that was with Rhapsody.
Yeah, it was with Rhapsody.
Slight flex.
Yeah, like right. What was that thing you did, Shereen? Anyway, for real though. No, this dude though. Yeah, like, shout out Rhapsody. Because the dude that I was eating with was one of the producers for the show, and he was telling me like, you know what I'm saying. My goal was always to retire when I was 45.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? And now he like lives in like Costa Rica or something. And he only flies. And he'll come in, produce something,
and leave, go back home.
And I'm out of here.
That's if he wants to, too. Like, you know what I mean?
That's if he wants to, because he doesn't have to. He said he has enough money now to live where he's at.
Financial freedom.
You know what I'm saying? Freedom, and be in that situation. So if I do have that like that capitalist mindset, then the next 10 years is like work hard enough and put myself in the right situations to where I have the choice to mm-hmm. do what I want to do. You know what I'm saying? By the time I'm 40 or 45, right? Like that, you know,
I feel you.
Definitely.
Yeah, man. 5-10 years, man. I'm like, I'm with you too. Like, I want to win a Grammy within the next 2-3 years.
Ooh,
you feel me? But
I ain't gonna lie, that's possible, man. Y'all in a good mix, bro. You definitely. One talented dude. Hell yeah, bro.
I'm trying out here, in these streets. Man. I'm trying out here.
What if you end up winning a Grammy, but it's not the way you expected? Like, if it wasn't. Like, let me restate that. Right, I said, so what if like y'all won a Grammy, but it's not how you expected? Like, you wanted to be on your project, but it happened to be like you did background vocals for like, you know what I'm saying, one part of a song.
Right.
How do you take that? What do you do with that?
I take that as okay. This is step one. Right, okay. Right, now next step is you feel me. So,
but it might be easier to catch the next Grammy.
Mm-hmm. Facts.
Man, I think that's dope too, though. Like, facts. I think I got. Yeah. Hopefully, I get vocal credits on that on Masego's new album. The word is born, though. If I get a Grammy off of that, I would be happy as hell,
bro. Oh, dude, you was a part of it.
Exactly. Yeah.
Doing something different too. That's versatility.
Yeah,
exactly.
That's
a big deal.
Wow. You talk about being a father.
Yeah.
Like, can you tell us like what? How has I gotta read it?
I was like, oh, he's going, man.
Matt's gonna be a millionaire podcaster in 5-10 years.
How has fatherhood affected like your artistry? Like, was it like a stark difference between before you had a child and then after? Was there a difference or like how has it impacted?
I would say before having kids. That's a good one. Let me think. Let me not just say some cool artists and really be for real. I would say before I was way more lax. Like in my life, like I've always hustled. You know what I mean? Like I didn't go to college. Like I left college because I was a barber, knew how to make money. So it's just like that was my mindset. Then I opened up a recording studio with my brothers. We was doing that. So like making music was always been a hobby, and like. That's how I was looking at it. Like, just make songs when you can, when it hits you, whatever. Now, right. Like, having kids is like, let's really take this on. I don't want to be a hustler no more.
I mean?
I really just want to,
go
like,
put in 100%.
On this artist life. Like, me getting that placement with Bumby was just literally me working on music with E during the middle of COVID, dead winter, when it really hit. We just making mad records. I'm trying to get some stuff placed for Christmas songs, whatever that I don't go through. Send out some records to a couple homies. Make you get that joint. Corey Guns was supposed to be on it originally. Then he hits me like, yo, Bun B on the Masinity. I'm like, you lying. I play it, I'm like, oh. I grew up on Bun B. And I'm not going to act like I'm the biggest fan. I'm saying just Uptown. Let's just say literally Uptown. Like Drake hearing Bun B on that. I'm like, yo, this is a world. This is a wild situation. So just kind of just being serious and like really being adamant about like getting everything I want done and working hard as hell to do it. Like, songs every day, beats every day. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, stuff that I hear all the homies go through, John, you, like, y'all working every day as artists. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's a real thing. So just just taking it on, and like I said, just kind of being a lot more serious about it as a dad now.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Hell yeah.
Yeah, John.
Real quick, hold on. I got a tattoo to show how serious it is. Yeah, I hope y'all get a little
protect her.
Hey, post.
Yeah, man, yeah.
Post
yeah.
editing
for the girls.
I'm gonna zoom in and post.
John, how's been being a dad has affected your drumming style?
How's being a dad? Oh, Max, clearly you're expecting. So how's being a dad?
Yo! Wow!
I thought this was my podcast. My day.
So next up on Roast Me.
I've been working out. What do you guys want to, what do you want people to get from your artistry? Like,
you go first?
I don't know. I guess a glimpse of who, you know what I'm saying, who I am. It's probably Cedric.
It's definitely Cedric. Nah, it's not Cedric. Food?
Black.
Oh.
Do you want anything
in
here?
No.
I'll
do
it.
Yeah.
Okay, finish.
Maria.
She's fine.
You want another one?
Hi, Maria.
There you go. You like him, right?
See you next time.
All right, take care.
Oh, you done got her hooked on the on the Yoruba dog.
Oh, man. I'm putting people on.
This dude funny.
That was a nice little surprise visit from my
Maria.
All right. What was I saying?
Artist.
Oh, yeah. How's your, what do you want people to get from your artistry?
Oh,
like as
yeah,
a drummer,
yeah, yeah.
especially.
Yeah, just a glimpse of myself. I feel like when people hear me play, I mean, I've been in situations where people are like amazed at my artistry or whatever.
Mm.
Not whatever, like, I take that very serious.
Right.
But I also just want people to see, a glimpse of me, you know what I'm saying? I want to be good enough on my instrument to be able to communicate my emotions, my thoughts, my feelings through that to people who might not be musicians.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like that's my goal. So it's like, you know,
what is there like any examples of that? Like what a musician that does that?
Yo, there's lots of musicians. I mean, I could just take it back to like college and being introduced to musicians like Max Roach, or just like, you know what I'm saying, like going through the whole jazz education thing and teaching you really how to improvise taught me a different way to look at the drums.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying, as a musical instrument as opposed to just like a beat, something to make beats.
Right, you know what I'm saying.
Like I'm beating on the drums, like nah, I'm playing the drums, you know what I'm saying, I'm playing music, you know what I'm saying, because music is a universal language, you know what I'm saying? And like being able to like approach the drums a certain way, like melodically or any kind of way, you know what I'm saying? Mm. Adding that with rhythms, you know what I'm saying? That's a thing. So, you know, that's what I'm trying to do.
I feel you. I think for me, like, I got some mind. What's going on today?
You about to cry?
Interior. Nah, but I think... Oh, you did it! I'm emotional now. Nah, but
yeah,
I think for me, like just for my music, I just want people to feel something. You know what I mean? Just like you were saying, like I want people to feel. I want people to just like associate a memory with my music. Like you know, you hear like for me, like 80s and 90s music. I'm like, oh, I remember this. I was, you know, here, there, doing whatever, but. I want just vibes, you know what I mean?
Hell so yeah.
No, definitely.
Just want to make people feel.
Same thing. I'll piggyback off of that. Definitely want people to feel. I want people to know, you know, where I stand on things too. Things I partake in that I may not promote on my social media where people can find me, but do listen to my music. It's like, oh, I know what you do, or I know how you think about things. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, just same thing. Like I said, just wanting people to feel and like. Just kind of get a glimpse of who I am. Because you never really, not to say you never know, but I feel like you won't get the full me through my music. You know what I mean? You got to know me. You got to know the way y'all know me. You know what I'm saying? So
Different
Yeah, it's different
aspects.
Levels. Yeah, exactly. Different aspects.
That's
very real. Yeah. Yeah, so, yeah, same thing, like I said.
Okay. So today, we're going to talk about some little different things today, okay. But I do have some questions that are submitted by Instagram.
Lit.
So we'll get into those too. But let me go back to my my cue cards.
That's what you need next, bro. You need the root. Oh, do. My God. lobby calls, fucking cue cards. That'd be sick.
There we go.
That'd be sick. Man, exactly.
Right. It says some questions that the listeners, you guys, have submitted were kind of like, you know, controversial topics, but we talked about it like a couple podcasts ago, a couple episodes ago, and it's about cultural appropriation and culture vultures. Mm. I know John said he wanted to be on that episode, so I was like, yeah, we're here. Yeah. John said in previous episodes that pretty much all music comes from black people, or most music.
American music.
American, yes, American music, absolutely. I agree with that. But and more recently, people have been talking about how everything on social media comes from black culture. Mm. And we're going to talk about music in particular, but there are all different kinds of cultural appropriation. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Whether it be from food, clothes, mm-hmm. the way you talk, mm-hmm. You know, dancing, everything. Mm-hmm. So culture, anything involved culture. So, let me get to the first question we got over here. So yeah, would you? And this is just a.
You getting messy with these questions?
No. We need this. I like this. Yeah.
And this is something like I just like, you know, because I recently, I'm on social media a lot too, so I peep things, and mm-hmm. so this is one of the things I kind of wanted to, you know,
address.
Yeah. Would you consider Justin Bieber having locks? John, you can probably speak on this because you have locks too.
Yeah, facts. But, my brother got locks. My twin brother has locks too.
Or Kardashian rocking Kim Kardashian, the Kardashians rocking cornrows cultural appropriation. Would you consider that?
I mean, the thing about locks is like,
real quick before you answer, in a way he's culture appropriating too, don't know, because he's not Jamaican, he's not Caribbean.
Locks come.
That's black. Let's get into it,
because it's a lot deeper than that.
Okay. Yeah, locks come from Africa. Yeah. So,
okay. All right.
So you know, during the mid Atlantic slave
trade,
you know, a lot of those
cultures,
the diaspora is spread around the mm-hmm. world, so mm-hmm. but it originated, I think, in Africa.
Facts. So, okay, but that's fair. Yeah. That's fair.
So technically, no, it would be cultural appropriation. Uh-huh. But
I think there's history of people all over the world that, especially darker skinned people, having locks or whatever. The thing about, you know what I'm saying, white people having locks, you know what I'm saying, I'm not going to talk specific. I didn't even know Justin Bieber had locks. And yeah, I like Justin Bieber.
I didn't even know he was calling those things locks, to be honest.
Yeah,
I
like, yeah, I going on. See, this is the thing. Not to disrespect, you know what I'm saying, anybody's locks or whatever, their relationship with their hair or whatever, statements they trying to make. Like, white people with locks is kind of, that should just be looking nasty to me, but that's just me. And I feel like it's more mm-hmm. trouble for a white person. It's like your hair doesn't, like black folk, like this is the thing.
Our hair naturally.
Yeah, mm-hmm. if you stop combing your hair, if you just wash your hair, mm-hmm. your hair will lock. Mm-hmm. If you just let it grow and you wash it, your hair is going to lock. Mm-hmm. Like that's a natural state of black people's hair. Like we have to maintain our hair to keep it from locking.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? It's a thing that we have to do. White folks, it's not like that. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, you wash your hair, it'll be fine. You know what I'm saying? You wash your hair, you leave it, it's going to be fine. You have to do something to, like, reinforce this locking of your hair or to do something to your hair texture. So it's like, I mean, if that's the type of decision that you want to make, that's cool. Mm. But is it cultural appropriation? It's like, ask them. Because they're the ones going through all of that work, you know what I'm saying, trying to do this and, you know.
That's cool, yeah.
Putting
cool.
shit in your hair. But, like, the Kardashians and stuff like that, I mean, I think at this point, man, you know, whatever, you know what I'm saying? Like, at this point, what you gonna say? You know, mm-hmm. like, they got, you know, I'm into, like, fighting sports, you know what I'm saying? So, in the MMA, all the female MMA fighters wear cornrows now. They got a braider that, this black lady that works for the UFC, and she braids everybody's hair before a fight. So, if you're a black fighter and you get cornrows before a fight, she gonna get you right. But all the female fighters,
they have to wear cornrows.
I mean, it's the easiest thing.
I feel like for something like that, I feel like that's like it's a reason why, because so they don't, you know, the hair doesn't get everywhere. Yeah.
If you start calling it boxer braids, then it's a problem,
right?
That becomes a problem. But when you're talking about the Kardashian stuff like that, I mean, it's, I don't know if it's cultural appropriation as much as it's like, y'all know who the dominant culture is when it comes to like what's cool.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and they family, the integration in it.
Exactly. So, like, yeah, mm-hmm. so I mean, you know. Is it appropriation? Ask them. I think, like...
I call it flattery.
Yeah. Yeah, there you go. I love to ask them, because the answer would be yes. You know what it is.
I think, like, a cultural appropriation is just, like, taking something from a culture and, like, trying to say it's yours. Mm-hmm. So, for example, like, when Kim, I think it was one of the Kardashians, they had cornrows, and then, like, all these fashion magazines say, oh, this is the new style, and this, that. No, we've been doing this shit for eons. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Literally. So I think it's a slight difference. And also, for me personally, I think, like, something is appropriation when you don't, you can borrow, I think society has borrowed something from different cultures, but not giving that, where you got it from, it's just due, and like, oh, hey, I got it from here. And you're trying to steal it like it's, oh, yeah, I created this shit.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? So I think that's, I don't know. What I consider Bieber having locks, cultural appropriation. If he...
Let's consider it gross.
It is. I feel like if you got to do that, of course.
Yes, it's a yes.
Now, a good question you said is he, you know, did you say he's calling it that? No, Jay, you said
I didn't know what he was calling it. I just seen the things on his head. I'm like, all right, he got, honestly, a lot of times people, they get to a certain amount of stardom and money. Like, you know, even with Chris Brown, they just start doing whatever the hell they want. So I'm just like, all right, they going through their phase. Now, the fact that he calling it locks, that's
what's
like.
That's what, right. That's what I was about to say. If he's not calling it locks, then do it.
The problem. Like you said.
They start calling it boxer braids. That's the problem. I'm claiming cultural appropriation, appropriating this culture because it works. I mean, call it what it is. But to play devil's advocate, that's what it is. Fucking gross. That's what it is. No, I'm just playing. I like Justin Bieber a lot. There have been cultures
even
before, like, you know, the United States was established, like Vikings, for example, they had their hair was locked up.
Yeah, but that's how we're talking about.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So it's just like, you know, I think some of the Slavs had locks and you know, but in this day and age,
right.
You know,
and they're definitely not looking at the Vikings.
No.
They don't want those braids. Those are shit dreads. Doodoo dreads.
Dreadful.
And yeah, exactly. Those are dreads. There's a difference between locks and dreads.
Yeah, that's those are dreads. Nigga. For listeners and viewers who don't know, I think the term dreads is kind of like a derogatory term for locks for black people, because I think it started in the islands when the British colony. Yeah, it was a British colony, and, you know, there were Africans there who had locks. They said they were dreadful, and so that's where that term got coined. Oh, so,
wow.
Yeah. That's why I don't... Research, man.
It's well-read.
No, but, you know, that's why I refer to locks as locks. I don't do dreads, but, you know.
Definitely just learned that just now. No more dreads.
It's a vibe.
Locks is beautiful.
Yeah, I try to say locks as much as I can. It's hard sometimes because growing up, that's what dreads.
It got coins, you know what I'm saying?
Of course. So,
but, yeah, I'll be trying to use that. I try to, you know, intentionally use that term.
Right, yeah, you got to mentally uncondition yourself from saying, you know what I'm saying? Whatever. Talk about another podcast. would you consider blue-eyed soul singers, is that's what we used to call them back in the day, cultural appropriators, going back to Bobby Caldwell, Tina Marie, all the artists like Adele and JoJo, etc.? I'll start.
Yeah, facts.
I think they're, if they give back to, like, you know, if they acknowledge, hey, I was heavily influenced by, you know, these, you know, black artists, Because I think about it like this. Like, if I wasn't black, and I see black people being cool as fuck as black people are, I want to do that too. Yep. You know what I'm saying? I want to be a part of this one. But I think the line crosses when they try to, oh, yeah, this is, you know what I'm saying? For instance, I think Elvis is a cultural appropriator. You know what I'm saying? Like, he stole the swag
thing. Chuck Berry, yeah.
You know what I mean? Barrett, yeah, man. Yeah, Chuck Berry and you know, so.
The king of rock and roll.
Yeah, but you
rock
got
and
it from.
Black music. Yeah.
Black music. Yep.
Yeah,
yep.
But, you know. Yeah, what do you guys think?
I think the same as you. I like that point. Just acknowledging those that came before you and who truly inspires you. Not like, oh, I was in the studio with blah, 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 and we came up with this great sound. No, this sound sounds very distinct to somebody else's sound. So I think that point is good. I don't know. I feel like Adele, well, but I guess I heard her first album, too. It definitely got that soul, that funk. OD. It's poppy. But yeah, right? It's funkin'. It got that vibe, but yeah, yeah. Yeah. I agree. You gotta acknowledge those before you, for sure.
I think I think with American culture, it's real easy for what black people do or our history of what we contributed to music to just get jumbled up in American culture. I feel like when like nobody is gonna literally take, you know, something from Chinese culture and try to do it without paying homage to where they got it from.
Right.
I think. With black Americans, it's like we don't have connection to a homeland. Mm-hmm. So people are not going to call hip-hop music African music.
Right.
So they're not going to be like, oh, I need to do this. Or a lot of times people don't see the importance of reaching back in American history and being able to discern what came from black folks and black the black experience in America and just American history, right? Like people be like, oh, jazz music is American. It's America's form of music. It's like, this is black. People music, like, yes, yeah, American music for the simple fact that we're Americans because we're here now, you know what I'm saying? But it's so easy for y'all to just take what we do and then say it's American music. So it's like Blue Eyed Soul, like, yeah, they slip under the radar because it's like, oh, this is just the American sound. Like, it's not the American sound. This is the black sound.
Yeah.
This is the black sound.
Do you think that our music, black music, would be as advanced and so much... have so much depth if we never came, or not came, but if we were never brought to America? Like, would we have hip hop? Would we have jazz? Would we have those other forms of music if we never came over here and got introduced to certain, you know, different kind of elements?
I think black people is just creative. Like, creative. So no matter what,
we're gonna be.
I just want to give an example, like, about this shit, because remember you put me on the watch. BG's documentary and the BG's whatever their music was, whatever it was, when they was over, and then when they came here, the music changed. It was like they created a sound. But in the documentary, I will say, they said, yo, we were just trying to be like the stylistics and all that. So it was like they did give the nod to them in the documentary, but before that, nobody was saying that. They were just like, the BG's created a new sound, which is like,
they didn't need to.
Come on, man.
I think, and it's partially because most of those people just probably didn't know where the sound was coming from, because it actually wasn't white people's music. So it's like, I didn't grow up listening to that. But then I think there was probably a large number of white folks that knew, or journalists or whoever was writing about the critics that knew exactly where the music. But in terms of like answering your question about like the black experience or like black people coming over here, of course our collective experience is what has created the opportunity for us to make this music. You know what I'm saying? But we still gotta just give credit to the history. But of course, I feel like, I mean, and I feel like sometimes we overlook the shit that's happening in Africa too. It's like, like when we talk about jazz and like all of the hip hop and all this stuff, it's like when you listen to the real music and where this shit is coming from, it's the same shit. It's like everything that we do comes from a feeling. You know what I'm saying? Some sort of feeling. It's rhythmic and it's you know, not to be sound drummer-ish, but it's like triplet bass. And then when you talk about like the music, you talk about jazz and the blue notes and all of this type of stuff. It's just the way that we did music, the way that we communicate, the way we talk. Niggas talk about slang, and it's like, oh, this, that, and the third. But it's like, niggas don't understand that in Africa, like African language, like people broke down their own language. Actual African dialects, which is like broken. They have a language, but it's like we speak broken. You know what I'm saying? Because this is how we communicate. You know what I'm saying? Or the way that, you know what I'm saying, the rhythm, the cadence, and everything that you do, this is inherent to us. Like, we are communicators. You feel what I'm saying? So it's like, that shit comes out in the music. You know what I'm saying? So all of that shit is like, it's directly tied to that shit.
Yeah, for sure.
It's like, you know? we spoke about this shit, like Young Thug or Playboi Carti. He's scatting on the track, basically. You know what I mean? It's the same how they used to do it.
That's real shit. Yeah, good point. But you know, I like a lot of those artists though. You know, Tina Marie's dope.
You definitely put up the worst people that I couldn't even frown upon. I'm like, damn, I like all of these people. My mother just brought up Tina Marie at our last family function.
And that's also Rick James.
Brought it, co-signed.
Man. My bad, I had it running.
Grab a battery.
Dude's just carrying on. Look, I'm like, oh, Max is on the go right now.
I was just going to do 500 push-ups really quick. Drink some muscle milk. I feel some type of way about that. I feel like that. It's okay. Do any examples of egregious cultural appropriation immediately come to mind when y'all think about it? I know for me, it was Elvis. Like Elvis, the Beatles.
I don't even know about the Beatles.
I don't know about.
I
mean, wasn't it the Rolling Stones that was taking all of like Muddy Waters stuff?
Nah, it was Little Richard.
They're taking stuff from Little Richard. Gotcha.
Little Richard, like low key, like made like the blueprint of just like what rock and roll.
Oh no, another forefather.
So
egregious stuff.
But for me, I think it's Elvis for me.
That whole era, dudes is getting taken out for a lot of stuff. Even I don't know this guy's name, man.
It was even stuff where they was taking, you know, like the black artists, they would just take, you know, they would take their vocals and put like a white band on the album cover for themselves. You know what I'm saying? They
Five Heartbeats even, type
you
stuff.
And then even like as time goes on, it would still be, you know, with black people in our culture, like with the image of people. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. If somebody was fat, a lot of the best house singers, the most famous house joints, was from people who were quote unquote unmarketable. You know what I mean? Like, these are big women from church singing in the choir.
Right.
And then they got a bunch of models lip syncing in the videos and stuff like that. So it was like, it's always that. We're always appropriating somehow, some way, man. Yeah.
Even with Bobby Caldwell, for the longest time, I thought he was black.
I just found that out, I swear, last month. Like, yo, wait, this guy's a white skinny
dude? What, this song right here?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Crazy, bro. Crazy.
Yeah, it's like, yo, what do you think? But, you know.
Definitely. Hey, like you said, as long as you're paying homage to where it comes from,
right,
you don't have an issue, especially when you do something well, because it's like...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
You know, I could hear that you know where this comes from.
Like, yeah, right.
You love this. Man, you love this. This, you might be white, but this black music pouring up out of you, because that's what you fed yourself with. So it's like, I try not to think about the egregious stuff like the like Iggy Azalea. I don't think about that kind of shit, because it's like that shit comes and goes anyway.
Yeah, you seen it.
Like, nobody cares. Like, what is she doing now? She probably regretted a lot of. I mean, she probably don't regret shit, but she probably regrets some things. It's like, this didn't really work for me.
Yeah, shouldn't have tried that time. Definitely
didn't work for you the way that you thought it would.
Right. So is the music industry like arguably like one big culture vulture?
Yeah, in a sense. Dudes is grabbing information and inspiration from everywhere. Definitely. There's always a new poppin' thing every 5 years that came from this region or this state. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Definitely. I absolutely think the music and industries in general, film industry, all of that.
Yeah.
Dudes is stealing ideas, scripts, styles. Yeah, it's man. Unfortunately.
Pop now.
Yeah.
It is. It's trap elements and everything that's on the radio and, you know, for not everything, but mostly everything. You know what I mean? So.
I think even with just like if you look at like,
I'm trying to make sure they can hear you.
I appreciate it. Thank you, though. I appreciate it.
That's very kind of you.
That's what Reese do too, bro, by the way, bro. Like,
very passive aggressive.
Tell you something about yourself, like, and they'll be like, I mean, I guess that's just you.
You're
like,
he's like, I mean, you're a failure, you're an asshole, but you know.
I mean, but that works for you. That works for you.
No, but what I was saying earlier is just like, if you look at just like Black music, even just today in the industry, like the highest people getting paid in these genres like R&B, hip hop, stuff like that were white, because they control, the labels for the most part.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And just even back
money.
Right. Even back when hip hop was like really starting to come up with like NWA and all these different rap groups and stuff like that. It was just like these label owners that weren't black people weren't owning, didn't have control over the industry, I should say.
Yeah.
I think it's only until recently now people started getting control over, because now is people not dependent on the
labels anymore.
On the big, you know what I'm saying? The big ticket used to be getting signed. Now it's like, yo, if I get signed, that's cool, but I don't need the label.
Yeah.
And most people now prefer, because it's like, they'll take the long way, but then the reward is even better. You getting all the money.
Yeah, independent.
Exactly. Even with streaming, like, streaming is a scam. I'm not going to go. I'll do a TED talk about streaming.
Yeah.
But like, you only get like 1% of your streaming.
Not even.
Not even 1%. I wish you 1%.
Dudes get 1% of 100 million streams?
Come on.
You mean like 0.00156 something.
It's a percentage of a penny. Yeah.
And we putting out blood, sweat, and tears, time, money, and all of that. And it'd be like, damn, like, I'm doing all of this to get streams to quote-unquote be lit. But it's still the machine is eating. Like, I think it's going to be a time when we won't need that.
That's like we said, though. It's industry in general, like all of that shit, because which is crazy.
I mean, so what do you guys think the solution is, like, for just like cultural appropriation,
kind of
the industry, the stream
kind
thing,
kind of like what he said, he was kind of speaking on a little bit, like, we got to do everything on our own. Imagine everybody having their own plot of land to shoot this film that they need to do. My own home studio, my own, photography team, my own whatever industry you in, you're in that space. My own union that's amongst the, 10 people I hired for the construction company. I'll never got to go through nobody. You know what I'm saying? Only thing I got to pay for is taxes.
Yep.
Depending on where I am, because my mother's in Delaware, so she ain't got to pay no taxes. You feel me? Like, it all depends on that. But I feel like that's where it all stems from. We always see it, too. We see everybody that comes in indie that kills it, and they, like, doing a partner deal with labels. As like opposed to people
Chance
that's going in. Yeah, you feel
like
me?
That,
Chance or Nipsey or Rockefeller. Feel me? Like, it's a lot of different companies that did that. But yeah, to me, that's how you cut out the middleman, man. It's just getting really in tune with your market, with your base, your fan base, your supporters, and just taking out anybody else that's trying to culture appropriate.
Everybody support cultural appropriators with money.
That's the only reason why everybody's still so connected to it.
I feel like a lot of times, like, I was just thinking about it, it's just like a lot of times the Iggy Azaleas and the, you know, I'm trying to think, Marky Marks, like, Mark Wahlberg,
right, Vanilla
and
Ice,
and, you know what I'm saying? A lot of times I think their supporters are mainly white people, white kids. You know what I'm saying?
Kids,
and
yeah,
so
definitely.
I kind of think it's like, I kind of put an analogy like a white girl dating a black guy who has like a racist dad or mom who don't really accept it. But if the black guy's like really light skinned, it's like, okay.
I get it.
All right.
Fact, right.
Exactly. A little bit leeway.
Facts.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. I get it. Yeah, I get it.
Eventually accept that shit.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, definitely. Absolutely, bro.
Oh, man. So I'm going to ask some, get some questions from IG, right?
Let's get it.
Issa Vibe.
Nah, no. Issa Vibe. _ Cam W.
Yeah,
Camel?
Camel,
okay. All right. Camel. Yeah, you should have just been confident. I was going with you on that, boy. Sorry.
She asked us to talk generally about misogynoir and colorism in the black community.
No way did you ask that. That's
like
hell of a question.
Yeah, you did. You're like, you know what?
Turn it up a little bit.
Cultural appropriation's not controversial enough. Right. Let's talk more.
Being misogynist is the person that cheats on people?
No.
It's the one that stays with the one person.
Misogynoir is like...
It's misogyny.
Also, real quick, this is why he's on his pod, because he's like always really advanced. So I needed him to help me out with these type of questions.
It's almost like it's similar to like patriarchy. You know, misogyny is similar. It's like a male dominated. Violence. You know what I'm saying, perpetuated by men,
right, towards women,
specifically, like in the black community too.
And whether it be emotional or physical,
any sort of like trauma.
Just being in control. And colorism. Well, we just talked a little bit about colorism. Light skin. And
That was a lot of it.
All of that shit exists, man. It exists in a lot of communities. But you know what I'm saying, misogynoir is something that niggas don't talk about in the black community. I mean, we don't talk about in the black communities because men,
We don't talk.
So it's a lot of things we don't understand. Also, man, it's a lot of everything has a term now, which on one hand I think is good.
Yeah.
But I think that it gets misused by a lot of people. Definitely. And then people want to just throw out terminology all the time. And most people don't even understand what the fuck they're talking about.
Right.
So it's like, you know what I'm saying? You try to have a conversation with a nigga about misogyny or rape culture or some shit like that, and they gonna feel attacked.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because like, I don't even know the words that you saying. Like, what the fuck is you talking about? Mm-hmm. And then on top of that, it's like, yo, you sitting here talking to me like, I ain't never raped nobody. I ain't never did this. Not realizing that there are certain things and actions
that
and
are
words that
technically
we use
considered rape.
Lovely, I mean, right? Which is like, which perpetuate that culture, you know what I'm saying? Which kind of advance that culture, because what we're not doing is educating ourselves to a point where we can make sure that we're not doing certain things.
Right.
But I think that we just, like he said, like, we don't really talk, but I think it's important for us to just start to become more educated about certain things so that we sure, because there's a lot of good niggas out here that really just don't understand what it is.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. That they could potentially be doing that's furthering this culture, you know what I'm saying? So it's like, we just need to generally be more educated about that shit. And then colorism, I think everybody already understands, like, the issues that we have. I mean, shit, nigga, light-skinned girls are in style, nigga. Like, these, like, racially ambiguous women, like, that's the style. Curly hair, light-skinned girls.
Literally.
That is what's in style.
Literally what you just said.
But and I think that, first off, that stems from back to, it's like a psychological legacy of slavery, right?
Of course.
So the enemy, both of them.
Right.
Do you think that's us, or that's the you know, big brother that's pushing that on us?
It's Western culture.
Because it's always been the light skin to me, light skin, curly hair.
Yeah, that's been
it. It had to be us to say,
my mother
this
is
black
light skin with curly hair.
Right,
so it's
my
like,
mom is.
Yeah, our mothers look like sisters. So it's no like, joke. Okay, we might just naturally be attracted to light skin.
Right,
you know, you're attracted to the idea of your parents or whatever.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So that might be a thing, but I think it's just West. I mean, nigga. You and I have been all over the world
Max, yeah.
Everywhere that I go. Everywhere that I go. We went to Indonesia.
Mm-hmm.
And you see the people in Indonesia, and these people are golden and brown colored people. But when you see the billboards, nigga, it'd be the lightest skin. I was like, I haven't seen any people here.
That's the thing, though.
When you go to China, it's like that. Nigga, when you go to Africa, you're in the airport. Everywhere I go, it's like I'm taking mental notes.
Yeah.
As soon as I get off the airport, I'm looking at a billboard. I'm seeing what are y'all trying to show us your country looks like.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? I feel like the whole idea of Western culture, especially like Western being the dominant culture in terms of like
European
money and power. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but the European, that is Western culture. It's European, whatever the fuck. Mm-hmm. Eurocentric.
Yeah. Yeah,
that shit is definitely mm-hmm. on everything, right. Especially in the Black community.
And just even going back to what I was saying earlier about the analogy I gave about the white daughter dating a light skin.
Yeah,
that's okay.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Yeah. And so it's just like. Like I said, this
come on in, Jamal. You guys still do eat chicken, right? Oh, okay. Yeah.
Did you not just say like, Jamal?
It's like chitlins. Yo, Jamal, we don't serve chitlins here. I don't know what that is. No, but
last name Jenkins.
Yeah, so it stems from. It's like a psychological legacy of slavery.
Definitely.
So back in the 1600s, I don't.
Let's go to Wikipedia.
Yeah.
That nigga started typing on his pecs, his abs and shit.
No,
according to my calculations.
If my calculations are correct, which I dare say they are. No, but I think that it stems from that. Yeah. And just like the trauma that we've gone as Black Ados, what does it stand for again?
I don't even know.
African descendants of slavery. American descendants of slavery.
That's the thing?
Yeah, Ados. Yeah, American descendants of slavery.
That's the third thing I learned. I'm saying so. Dreadlocks, Ados, and massage noir.
No, but it stems from like the trauma of just like, you know, white is right and black is whack. Or, you know what I'm saying? So. What you were to your point about these racially ambiguous women that you know light skinned girls that you saying that are in style, you know I think that there's a psychological thing for maybe Black men
mental conditioning
to like okay to think that lighter is better and it's around the world too you know what I'm saying so it's kind of like a
it's like Black magic. Black cat cross you. It's like
right. That's what I'm saying. Yes,
it's like a beauty. That's a great and everything. Point, boy.
Yeah. Everything.
I've had conversations, vague conversations with a few white people about that. Like, and just bringing stuff up like that. Like everything that's black is automatically negative, and everything that's white is so pure and good.
Right.
You know what I mean? Turn up the lights. Oh, I'm scared. Like, it's like, bro, everything black is associated with negativity. So, yeah, I think that's, you know, those are things we end up talking about if you're willing to get the information. But I don't know. I was going to say really quick, I wanted to talk on the idea of colorism and even massage noir. It is being spoken about, I feel like, more than ever in our community.
Yeah.
I don't know about people older than us, but definitely I think this generation people are at least having this put on the table. You know what I mean? Black men being in the house. I'm speaking for me too. Like me being a first time dad and saying I'm gonna stay home and work on music whenever I can, and my girl go out and work. That's I'm sure my father low key probably like what's going on here?
Right, exactly.
I'm still making my money, but it's like you're not even. I don't care what you're doing. Get out of the house and let the ladies. You know what I'm saying?
So challenging social norms.
Yeah, man.
Construct.
Exactly.
It's funny you say that because like when I stopped working and my girl still goes to work and my grandmother was like better than me and my friend was like yo that just me she's stupid like you know what I mean that's how black people just like I wouldn't do it but it's crazy it's changing the narrative you gotta do that though bro you have to do that.
I mean you got to look at like how our parents and grandparents were raised like the family structure how they were how it was just like the man goes out and he provides and protects the mom stays home and nurtures and takes care of the household and you know. So that's how people are so used to it. That's why your grandma's like couldn't be me because she's so used to.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
The crazy thing is too a lot about all of that conditioning is that it's not even that far off from the generation that we in now, like our generation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As we think about it, like most of our grandparents, they was around during segregation times.
That was like 50 years ago.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. And they show us the pictures in black and white, make us think. And all it was just technology. Just technology. Yeah. And the thing is, like, even about colorism, I'll make it short, but like in terms of why. You know, even to this day, it's like, light skin, right skin kind of thing. It's because even the conditioning from when since our people have been brought here and broken down and butt breaking into slavery, you know, the house niggas,
they don't want to talk about that.
You know what I'm saying? The people who did less work, who were more envied, were white people. Post slavery, when there was still segregation, you know, the people who were getting more money, who were getting more jobs, were light skinned women. You know what I mean? Like the black skin, like the women with darker skin, they were shitting on. Mind you, women in general. Always,
especially black women. Especially. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Especially. It be by us, and then it also be by them, and then by the rest of the world. Yeah. Which is why it's even important where like certain social norms or social constructs, like what you were saying about being as a black man, being there for your family.
Yeah.
It's like, you know what? Both realizing like, yo, we both are. When we step outside of this house, we already got the world attacking us, so we need to be a union. Yeah, and whatever problems we do have, we need to be together. Able to talk about that shit.
Yeah, right.
Instead of beefing about it and not being mature enough to recognize your own mistakes.
Right,
you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Being like, you know what? I was wrong. Even if it's not in that moment, like, yo, you know what? I was wrong. You know, but also you misunderstood because you thinking about some shit you saw on Instagram the other day, and you taking that into this relationship, whether you realize it or not, type shit. So it really be that communication, man.
Communication is key. Yeah.
And to kind of piggyback off what you're saying, just with colorism, it's just like that is a divisive method of division. Right?
Yeah.
The Willie Lynch letter. I'm not sure if that's a real thing.
It's not really real. It's not historically accurate. They said that the writing in the letter doesn't coincide with the time when they say it was written.
Oh yeah,
like the writing style.
But it's still real though. You know what I mean?
Not actual.
So what? It might have came out 20 years later, kind of thing.
That shit is probably just not
phony. Okay.
But it has a lot of like of the stuff that's in there. You can see it even with colorism. It's just like pin the light skin against the dark skin, old against young, men against the women. That way they're always fighting. There'll never be any unity. Even with the Ados, black people here with Africans in the homeland.
Yeah,
like
it's a big division.
There's like they think, you know, it's a bunch of miscommunication that are and lies that are spread through, you know, whoever's spreading, you know.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, we know.
But man, so that's why people in Africa, that's why a lot of black people here think that Africans are just, you see them on the media shows them big bellies like me. And with flies flying in their eyes. And they think, Africans think that. Speaking of gorillas.
Got him.
He's trying to fry.
No.
He said monkey back.
See, this is that look. Colorism thing right there.
Willie Lynch.
That colorism right there.
Look, we got his fight.
Got a crazy laugh over
there.
All right. Yeah,
and Africans over there think that black people here, all of us are like thugs and lazy and this, that, and other. It's just a lie. And propaganda has been spread to both sides to keep us from unifying. You know what I'm saying?
And we believe that shit too.
Yeah. Some of that is our fault. Because a lot of them, not for nothing, and it's not to knock the popular music, but a lot of the popular shit in our culture, the videos showing the same shit.
Mm-hmm.
So if that's old people in, like, let's say that's old people in Germany see, when you go out to Germany, they're like, yo, what's up, my nigga? Popping glocks. You know what I'm saying? That's kind of, that is the media. But that's us too.
I feel both of y'all, it's both ends.
But that's because
we need money.
But you gotta seek the information.
This is like, the thing.
But we're in 2021. What don't we know? We have literally a personal assistant in our phone. But anytime it's telling me, yo, what does this look like? What does this feel like?
Keep going.
You feel me? Like I don't know. That's like, yo, I have this conversation with my brother all the time. My older brother Glow is like, people that's coming, let's just say, from the hood. Some people choose to do something different because I just don't want to be here because I know this is a setup and I'm looking further out from the elephant. You feel me? Mm-hmm. The idea of, yo, I'm standing right in front of the elephant. I can't really see what's going on. Or basketball analogy. I'm in the game. I can't really see outside this game. I just see my defenders.
You're right.
So if I'm able to get outside of that, I could kind of, you know, grow and become something instead of being stuck in this space. Some people choose not to do that. I think it's on that same level. Like, bro, you can, some people want to read, learn new words, massage noir. Some people look at that like, okay, I don't know what that is. I don't care. You feel me? Like, you got to be willing to learn and seek the information, son, especially now.
Like, can I just, I just want to say,
no, that was it. I just feel like you got it.
Pass it to him.
Okay.
All right, so it's like, all right, because I grew up in the hood, too, and like you said, some people just, like, do other things, you know what I'm saying? What you're exposed to, too, or whatever, but... Push it in front of his mouth.
You gotta be able to make it, cause you don't want to listen back and niggas can't hear you. That's right, trash. You know what I'm saying?
So am I good right
now? Wait, I want to cut this myth, cause Sego said this one time when I was crying. You definitely can hear every single thing in this room. These microphones are fantastic.
No, I'll say this. That's because of post editing. I'll just do it in post. That's because of me.
Sorry about that. Good.
I'm the one that is in the
room. Oh, that's what I was saying. Definitely.
What you're exposed to. Like, all right, so, like, you exposed to, like, because, like I said, I grew up in the hood. So I come outside, and you see the drug dealers, and they getting money, right? All right, they getting money. You see his flashy shit. They getting all the girls. They doing all this, whatever, whatever. Then you see a bus driver, and he's coming home from work tired, doing whatever, whatever. But you never see them going home, not knowing the drug dealer lived in his mother's house. You know what I mean? You don't see the behind the scenes. You just see... Right here, you know what I mean? It's everything is perception. Everything is perception. So it's like what you're exposed to, bro. I was fortunate enough to have a father figure in the house to show me a different way. You know what I mean? That was actually working his ass off, and I'm coming home comfortably, you know what I mean? To my friends, and I seeing them like, damn, he's really fucked up. Like, you know what I mean? His mom's is on drugs or whatever the case may be. You know what I mean? It's just like, he don't know no better, bro. He can't, how is he going to be exposed? He's not exposed to it. Even going to different schools, bro. Like, we went to BCS. I was able to walk to school a different way. I'm passing. I'm seeing all the brownstones. Like, damn, I kind of want that. And these other kids are just going to their own school. It's just from the hood, and it's right across the street. Yeah. And they're growing up in the projects. Everything is there. You're not even going outside nowhere because your food is there. The grocery store, everything is right there. So you're boxed in.
Wait.
Some people. A few, but it's the minority.
Every time, no matter what, it's always the minority. What was you gonna say?
I was gonna say all of that you're saying. All of that is, it is a conscious effort from the government, from whoever, the powers that be. Like, they are doing that on purpose. Exactly. These projects are like they're like a thing. Like, they were planned. Like, the government has hired like psychologists and these things, they do social experiments all the time, all of this small scale, then they move it to the large.
I mean, like, and that's what I want to say, because everything that he talking about, because I have the same conversation with my mom, because I grew up in a comfortable situation, but both my parents are from the hood, and it's like my mother always talking about y'all was
our rich cousins, by the way.
Yeah, we were the rich cousins. That was rich to our cousins. But everybody that I came up around, it's like, if I go to school with rich motherfuckers, I'm the poor nigga at school. But when I'm around my cousins, I'm the rich cousin.
Exactly. It's a hierarchy.
So it's like, yo, this shit crazy. I don't know where I'm at. I'm in the middle. You know what I'm saying? But, like, my mother always be like, yo, you know, I made it out and blah, blah. And I always remind her, it's like, yo, you the minority of the people that you grew up with. Mm-hmm. When you talk about out of 10 motherfuckers that you grew up with, if only two or three of y'all made it out, it's not because y'all was just better than everybody else. It's because you might have had an opportunity that somebody else didn't have. And I noticed that shit because all my friends are hood niggas.
Right.
I got a lot of hood nigga friends. And it's like, yo, why is it that I'm able to do this and I'm able to do that? My life is going in this direction. My life is going in that direction because I've had opportunities that other niggas haven't had. Some of my closest friends are smarter than me.
But it's like, yo,
what are you going to do? And then we talk about social experiments. Like, if you take a person and put them in a situation, they're going to eventually become that situation because that's what humans do. They adapt.
Right.
So you're talking about niggas growing up in the hood. The majority of people that grow up in a box are going to live their life in the box. This is the world. And as a human, you're going to adapt to the situation that you're around. Most people just make the best out of what's in front of them.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So that's what it is. So my mother's like, yo, pull yourself up by your bootstraps. And this, that, and the third. And it's like, yo, that's the minority.
Yeah. Because
that's not, in actuality, I don't really think it's much about, it's a lot about putting in the personal effort, but it comes from the tribe, bro. Like, Mm-hmm. We, at the end of the day, we coming up as kids, like you said, if it's a kid who's growing up and they father's a murderer, you know what I'm saying? Like, he laying bodies down in the hood, like, whatever the hell kind of crazy shit he's doing. That kid is going to grow up like, I, like, desensitized to murder. And that's just, like, a small, like, little example of it. But having that foundation of, like, all right, my aunt, she's going to school to be a doctor. My sister, she likes ballet. My mom, she works in the hospital so many hours a week. So, in that overall foundation, like, wow, I see something bigger that I could do because my aunt's wanting to be a doctor. I see that I want to work, but I want to be busting my ass and tight like my mom's. But I see I should still be a dreamer and be free like my sister. Mm-hmm. Those things that's around... You know what I'm saying? Those are things that kind of that really influence us. So like, if it's dudes like us, you get into a certain level, and then it's like you trying to stay out of the bullshit of the hood, but you know you still got people you love in the hood. Yo, yeah, yo, what's good, bro? What you doing? Mm-hmm. Yo, I'm about to go take a trip to LA. I'm gonna take you to New York. Try to get as much bread as you can. Yo, matter of fact, if you know they gonna go to the street for the bread, yo, I'm gonna see what I can do. Yeah. If we can, like, it gotta be those kind of things. Oh, yo, I'm gonna hit you up. Yo, how you been, bro? What's going on?
Yeah.
Yo, I heard about yo, you going through this situation, bro? I went through that. Remember, I was moving this, that, whatever, and shit was getting too sticky for me. Mm-hmm. I think, honestly, bro, yo, they giving, it's free programs where you can learn how to code, bro. You can get a job starting at 6 figures. You be done in 4 months, my nigga. Yeah. You don't got to go on, you can go on YouTube and learn this shit. Right. Yo, start a t-shirt, everybody start a t-shirt, but yo, get
a business.
All it's so, it's mad shit. It's like, we got to reach back for dudes. Yeah. We can't, like, really go off and then forget about the people that are next to us. But some of the people, like we already said, some of them don't want to go nowhere. Mm-hmm. And some people that I was in a struggle with, and I'm like, yo, watch when they get lit. And they're like, yeah, word, bro. And then when the move's actually being made, I'm like, yo. And they like, nah, like, they don't want to be around that. Because some people, they're comfortable with that. They're comfortable with being, without worrying about being disappointed because they're taking them chances and shit like that.
It would be dope for that to become the minority. That becoming the minority and people getting out and creating their own becoming the majority.
Yeah, that's what
that would be sick, and then that would seem even. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Where it's like, all right, finally, dudes is able to get some sort of running start.
That's all people don't realize. It's not like, oh, white people are this, and that's why I have an issue with the whole pull yourself up by your bootstraps thing,
because
it makes it seem like,
oh, everybody has bootstraps.
90% of niggas are lazy.
Yeah, like it's a
10%
yeah,
of
it's really
of
not
black
that
niggas
yeah.
that make it out the hood because they are how everybody should, this is how all white people are. No. Mm-hmm. The difference is these motherfuckers have opportunities and opportunities to make mistakes.
Facts.
Niggas don't grow up with opportunities to make mistakes.
That's
you make a mistake and it's like, yo, this shit's fucking me up. I might go to jail now. I got a record. I got this. I got that because I made a dumbass decision.
Yeah.
Or something like that. White people, it's like you make a mistake, you get brushed off. And you make another mistake.
Right.
You make another mistake. You have opportunities to learn and shit like that. And, you know what I'm saying? That's all niggas need.
Just to piggyback off all what everybody's saying, it's like, originally I'm from Long Island, New York. And we were kind of well off. You know what I'm saying? Like, we were the rich cousins.
I ain't no bitch, though. Tell them, Reef.
You out here swole now, you know?
Yo, no, but when we moved down to Virginia, y'all niggas. We moved down to Virginia to this place called Berkeley, Norfolk, in Norfolk, Berkeley though. Shout out Berkeley. But it wasn't like, it was kind of like the hood, low key. Not really, but
close enough.
Yeah, a stark difference from Long Island to here to Berkeley, and like, it is your environment, right? And like I said before, there's a conscious effort to keep black people down. It's a thing. Like, from redlining to just,
the history is so dense.
So blowing up affluent neighborhoods like Tulsa, and just so you see y'all growing, y'all not about to have no skyscrapers.
Yeah, we're not.
Right.
Turn this over.
Y'all trying to inspire other black people
other
to make it for themselves?
Yeah.
Fire.
Right. Facts, bro. And it's happened multiple times. Yeah, man.
But yeah, it's a thing, man. It's a mental, it's a culmination of just environment, mental conditioning, and just the conscious effort from the powers that be to keep black people down.
Yeah,
so
yeah, yeah.
It's easy to get fed the bullshit through the phones. Mm-hmm. So like, you like, honestly, bro, and I say this a lot, like, yo, if it wasn't for, you know, me being doing music, I wouldn't be on social media. But I'm quite sure I probably would still be, because it's
1,000%.
Look, not for nothing.
It's the new TV.
Go, you feel me? It's like, yo, the way our homie Darren describes it, It's that hit of dopamine. You know what I'm saying? It's like, yo, you right on there, you can scroll through this joint and find any kind of source of whatever you need. You want to see some bad joints, some beautiful looking women, go in there. You want to see some new music, go in there. You want some news, whether it's fake or real, you can go in there. Like, mm-hmm. it's turned into that, which is that social conditioning and shit.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. I'm gonna go to the next question. Right,
move on because I was about to say.
I'm gonna go to
spitting facts.
Yeah, yeah, it's true. That's true. I'm gonna go to the next question because my camera's about to, the film about to run out. But
fade to black.
Elise underscore Jackson. She asks, "What are you doing to support and elevate Black women?" Okay.
I take that one.
Right, yeah, right.
I take that one. I got a Puerto Rican lady, but I'll be looking at anything Black and brown.
She Afro Latina, bro. Yeah. She got a whole Afro,
all,
nigga.
All of us is in this. Yeah, yeah. So, I just felt like I had to say it's 2020.
I feel you.
Got to
clarify everything.
Got to. Number one, supporting Black women specifically. I've been making a lot of music that's pushing the Black woman's, narrative in a different way. So talking about, yeah, exactly, great, praising women. So I have a song that I'm talking about, Toni Morrison to Sada Shakur to AOC. You know what I mean? I want to see the next person that's really important because I watch mad documentaries. You know what I mean? So number one, writing music specifically that speaks on the heroes and heroines of our time, and then also literally like on social media, just make sure you're doing your effort to push somebody that started, like you said, starting a new business. I'm just trying to really like tangibly do things that's in real time. I'm actually doing it, and then through my art, like just profess that positivity about Black women and Black people in general, but definitely Black women for sure.
I think even on a micro level, it's just like just being the best man I can be towards like my mom, my sisters, my nieces, my sisters, you know what I'm saying? And just, continue to perpetuate, just a healthy environment for Black women and to protect them. Yeah, like, literally like,
tattoo comes,
you know what I mean?
Protect.
So, yeah,
I agree. I agree with both. I feel like it's important. You know what I'm saying? Knowing the history, like, actually, like, for niggas to not just be trying to tell people, like, oh, history of Black women, like, actually knowing the history and, like, respecting, Black women that have done things that's like, nigga, I couldn't even have done that shit. No way I could have done that. But, what I'm saying? But then also, like you said, like, doing that shit around you, being the best person that you could be, make sure that you're not perpetuating that negative culture or violence against Black women and creating a better environment for them to thriving. And then also like remember, like, yo, Black women are like the most educated group of women of people in America,
the strongest thing on the planet.
So it's low-key sometimes it's like the best thing that you could do is just get the fuck out the way and support them in that way too. It's like, yo, I'm gonna let you do this, like, I don't like Black women don't need help doing everything. So it's like some people might be like, yo, how do you support Black women, like opening the doors? Like sometimes it's like not opening the door for them. That's like real shit though, like not doing that, because it's like, yo, you like, not because like you can do this on your own, but it's like, you don't need me. Like, why do I need to feel like you need me to do this or you need me to do that? Like, nah, you got this.
Yeah.
The best way probably is just to let, like y'all was saying, just let women be women.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And let them feel safe just being themselves.
Well, and you
feel me? Like, yeah, because it's like, at the end of the day, like, what I've noticed now, and I think it's kind of like, in a lot of ways, done overkill because a lot of women feel like they got something to prove in the sense of like, yo, I F this dude, or I mess with this kind of dude, whatever, or if a nigga ain't getting no money, this and that, like, yo, if that's what you want to do with your life, do your thing. But within the parameters, I'm going to make sure, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, if I see you doing something that I really think is, like, hurting you more than it's helping you, if you got the time and want to hear my opinion, I will humbly share it. If not, I'll shut the fuck up and make sure nobody disrespecting you in the meantime. But it kind of comes with that. Like that fine line of minding your business and being always being kind of on call, but this shit is a lifetime of condition that we breaking.
Generation.
No one answer to this shit.
Generations of condition. Yeah,
man.
That's some real shit.
Definitely.
Let's see.
He's gonna be bleeping out everything.
Edit. Oh, no cursing?
No, I'm joking.
Max is a fool.
Mujani07 asks, would you rather be globally known? What's a good question? Or underrated but owning your masters? Oh, that's a good question.
Yeah. I just signed an indie deal too.
Oh, right.
Yeah, facts. Thank y'all. Yeah. Actually, word. Yeah, facts. Damn. Ask would you rather be cooling or underrated? Oh man, I'm gonna keep it 1,000. I'm gonna keep it a big 1,000. Since our common friend is Sago, and after talking to him, he scares me. So we're gonna go with I'm gonna go unsigned, man. I'm gonna go with like doing this on your own. Owning everything if you can. Even in my situation, is a partner deal. So I still have my master's. You feel me? Like, I'm getting way more than, you know what I mean, what people normally get. So I would say go that way. Because it's a long and rigorous route. Like, man, tell me, it's tough.
Ask me how I know.
Yeah, we know how you know.
Ask me how I know.
It's a tough road, but... Everybody says it. This is a common thread that I feel like all the famous people say. The best part of it is the journey. The best part of it is you getting from, yo, I had 0 followers to 10 followers to now 1,000 to people hitting me, asking me, where's my music coming out? Whenever my new thing is coming out. You know what I'm saying? So, I don't know. I think going that route is cool until you feel like, yo, we hit a ceiling and right. We really need this.
Yeah.
But we've heard so many countless stories of people that were able to make it through without having to get that. You know what I mean? Right. I think it's just your intention and like being very specific about what you want. You know what I mean?
Right.
Having the like foresight to see where you're going. You know what I'm saying? The vision.
I agree. It just depends, honestly. For me, I used to think like, oh yeah, just, you know, independent. I mean, well, actually, no. I used to think
other way. Sign, yeah.
Sign,
yeah.
Like, you know, all of you us. Get more clout. Yeah, you get more. You know, absolutely. You have a machine behind you pushing your brand, pushing your music.
Yeah.
But on the flip side, they own your masters for however long. But you just
usually when you sign, you done for though. You don't get your masters. They're taking it like.
Yeah. Well, it depends what kind of contract. Facts, you have, right.
Obviously, standard, obviously. Standard, yeah, I'm saying standard like big deal.
You're Dunsky. But.
Whatever you release through that company, they own. Yeah,
that's theirs. Yeah. Yes.
But it's like, back in the day, it was like we said before earlier, like back in the day, like getting signed was like the, you know, you know what I'm saying?
Success. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. But now, as technology is advancing, we have our own studios at the house.
Yeah.
We, you know, we learn to mix our own stuff.
Who's that? So my GoPro.
Okay, I got you on that camera. but you know, we have Instagram. We can market ourselves, and we're coming less and less dependent on big labels. You know what I'm saying?
You got distributors now, too.
Yeah, distributors, and this, that, and the other.
Definitely. Everything.
So I just think it just depends on what you want as an artist. If you're looking to go like a pop route and you want this, you know, then maybe you might need to sign to a label. Make sure your deal's, you know, good.
As good as it could be. Yeah.
As good. Right. Yeah, either way, you're going to get fucked in the deal. Yeah, but it's just how bad you're going to get fucked. That's the thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just how bad.
Yeah.
But, you know, if you build a following before you get signed and you have the leverage and you get the clout, then you have more leverage for the contract and, you know, it won't be as bad. But for me personally, where I am right now, I think...
indie.
Okay, indie.
I think it depends on how fast you want to get there.
Yeah.
How fast you want to get there. You want to sound and get it now, but you still putting in the same amount of work, or keep it on your masters.
Facts. We know a few people. We know 2 different people, literally, like that from this trip. We're going to LA. Mm-hmm. We see 2 different people that have to still put in a lot of work, definitely. And they're signed to big labels, like. Not jokey, the major labels.
Yeah,
like, y'all working your asses off.
Yeah,
like,
they just fronting the money, I think, at this point.
Yeah, I mean, that's what it is. These labels are fronting a loan, so you got to pay off that loan, and then they also obviously have connections through, you know, companies, through pubs, TV, you know, movies or whatever the case may be, managers, but it's like, at the end of the day, you're just paying back a loan, bro. You're going to meet all those people when you start making this incredible music and getting outside and whatever the case may be, like, I don't know.
Yeah. So for the listeners and viewers, Like usually how it goes is like you get an advance, right?
Yeah.
The label will give you a chunk of money, mm-hmm. and that will cover expenses. Yeah,
let's say $2 million.
Right.
Yeah.
Which is
substantial.
Yeah.
You know, $2 million.
A lot of niggas be getting that.
Big time. Yeah.
Oh, you got a good deal.
$2 million like advance type.
Yeah.
Or they think you got a good deal.
Right.
So you get a $2 million advance, and so that'll cover, you know, production costs. It'll cover marketing, like billboards and stuff like that. That costs money. Yeah. Studio time, producers, you know, all of that.
Yeah.
And then they give you an advance, but you don't get that money back. You have to get it recouped. So that means that you get it recouped. That means, like, let's say you're selling, I don't know, 50,000 albums or EPs or whatever. And just for hypothetically saying you sell it for $1 each. So you get $50,000, you get none of that. Mm-hmm. That goes straight back to the label, mm-hmm. until they, get back. Until they get back that $2 million that they gave you.
Probably be some tax on top of that.
Oh, yeah.
Because they're going to throw in extra shit. So on top, they're going to give you an advance, and then it's like, you probably going to ask for something, and you probably going to get. During that time, they got you by the balls.
Yeah,
right.
You know what I'm saying?
They're usually paying for everything. Like, mm-hmm. they give you that, and you're covering studio time, photos, videos, features, this and third. You think you got X, Y, and Z money,
being flown out.
Exactly. Parties.
It's a whole bunch of things that come into, like, okay,
the play of signing, and then you end up realizing, I have to make. I got to pay all that stuff back, and
you know what I'm
end up being broke. Or hopefully you're dope as hell, and you. Skyrocket.
We talked about that last
which isn't a thing, motherfuckers don't know how to, that's not
financial
a,
literacy
a thing.
Is a real thing, definitely
a thing, bro.
And that's low-key by design as well, but
Pythagoras, get out of my face.
As I say, like, your oppressors are not going to educate you on how to be free. They're not going to teach you what you balance in a checkbook. I still don't know about checkbook. Or do your taxes. Like, what?
That's some real shit.
Let's see. Last one. We got Kamani Dunn. What up, Kamani? He asks, you ever ate a bowl of cereal with water instead of milk?
Nope.
Man, yo, people are doing that though. The frozen fruit with coconut milk.
Shut up.
Coconut water.
I'm vegan. I'm telling you to shut up. This shit is stupid. Why are you doing that?
Cereal, nigga.
If you eat fruit, you already eat fruit. First of all, why the hell are you going to drink
water.
Some cold ass?
Yeah,
what
water.
Is it?
It's coconut water.
Coconut water.
Yeah.
And ice. Why am I? I don't even want my cereal to be that cold.
Yeah.
Ice cold.
I tried it because I saw it on Friday. He was like, you better put some water on that shit. So
In the cereal.
As a kid, to try it. And my mom pressed me out like, what are you doing?
That's because Friday said you better put some water.
But I was a kid. I was going.
You put a little skim milk in it, and then you put a little water in it.
Well, back in the day, so I'm the youngest of 11. Same parents. And like,
youngest of 11 kids?
Yeah, same. Yeah.
This nigga grew up in the 40s.
Yeah.
This nigga's a sharecropper. This nigga didn't have shoes till he was 7.
Nah, but like,
just dusty feet.
I put work in.
Oh, chopping tobacco.
Nah, but like, you know, growing up in a family of 11. And, you know, we didn't have, especially when we moved from Long Island back down to VA.
Yeah.
You know, we weren't rich at all. We spent with 11 kids. We used to use this thing. We didn't have, like, milk. We had, like, canned milk, evaporated milk.
Oh, I definitely know what that is.
You add water in that bitch.
That's what I was saying.
Yeah.
That shit might taste better than regular milk.
People that
it's a little bit more creamier. A little better.
You gotta figure it out. That's fire, actually. That's actually very fire.
You know.
I never did the water shit.
Bro. Yeah, no.
So I'm from Camden, New Jersey. We don't do that here.
I'm not from Camden.
Oh. Where you from?
I'm from Edison. I grew up in Edison.
Oh, okay.
Talk your talk, Jersey, man.
Yeah, man.
Here we go.
You feel me? And I can fight.
I did say he came out to L.A. flexing, right? You know what
I'm
saying?
I'm a nice guy, though. I'm a jazz drummer.
Oh, shit. Some people get fucked up a lot, though. Like, jazz dudes, it's a lot of gangsta-ass jazz dudes.
Oh, yeah, that's the most gangsta. This is the most gangsta art form ever.
Miles Davis?
This is the most gangsta art form ever.
Miles Davis.
Nah, different level.
Jazz musicians used to walk around with guns and
guns and switchblades.
The rappers of
literally,
today,
yo, yeah, because at one point that was the music. That was the music of the time. Without a doubt.
Yeah, jazz dudes, man.
Yeah. All right, guys. I think that's it, man.
Gucci.
That's good.
That was a good episode. Yeah,
it was.
But that was a lot of gems, man.
Yeah. Before we go, though, I'm gonna. You guys can tell the viewers your IG. Follow us. Damn, it's been so long. All right, guys. Follow us on Instagram. We got. I'll let you guys give you guys Instagram.
All right, E King. Instagram is E King, 2 underscores.
Okay, you fancy it. He said, dude.
2 of them draws.
I had to.
Yo. Also, real quick before we finish, I wanted to say, we got a record placed with this TV show called Johnson.
Ooh.
Yeah. I should have mentioned that. My fault, bro. I'm sorry. When you asked, I'm bugging. Anyways,
no, you're good.
So it's going to be on this show called Johnson, executive produced by Cedric the Entertainer. D.L. Hughes going to be in it. It's going to be. There's a bunch of black people in this room.
Yeah.
This is the question of the day. Do y'all know, have y'all ever heard of Bounce TV?
Yes.
Bounce, yeah.
Okay, cool. That's cultural appropriation. You ask to certain people, they're going to be like, no, I don't know.
That's also some out-of-town shit, too. That's like out of New York.
Facts. So, yeah, it's going to be on Bounce TV. Again, it's called Johnson. We on the 3rd episode. It is in August 13th.
Lit.
Mad excited. It's our first placement together, too.
That's fire.
Yeah, man. I'm really, 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 really excited about this stuff. So, yeah, but, yeah, man. All that to say, my name is Shareef Keys.
Shareef Keys.
You can find me on all social media. That's Shareefkeys.
I'm gonna put it on.
Yeah. Oh my man. All right. Come on. Hey,
I'm my biggest fan.
I'm so used to doing shows. I'm so used to doing shows and having to spell it out. But yeah. You know what I mean.
Yeah, I got all y'all. Don't worry.
Man. Y'all got
the album dropping.
Yeah. Yeah.
August hopefully.
Yeah. Exactly. Collaborative project is coming out soon. I got singles coming out for sure. Starting in June, let's say roughly. A lot of things happen. I'm getting on Max's new project. Listen, man,
yes,
put
sir.
It in here, you're
yes,
put
sir.
It in here, exactly. Done.
Yes, sir. Right. No, you literally is gonna be a next
project. Right.
John, follow John on
Follow me, follow my band. You can follow me at Louis Vuitton John on Instagram.
Yes, sir.
It should spell like Louis Vuitton and then J-O-N. All one word. And follow my band, Zoo Crew Official, Z-O-O-C-R-U Official.
100,000 streams on Spotify. 100,000 streams.
We're a real independent, like super duper, all independent, you know what I'm saying? Jazz fusion, Afro fusion band out of Durham. You know what I'm saying? We out here. We just dropped a single called Honey. It's available on all streaming platforms. You know what I'm saying? I appreciate you.
Amazing, amazing.
Make sure y'all go check that out. It's a little something different for your palate.
Yo, big shout out to Dan also changing his name on social media. Dan, we love you, baby.
Yeah,
I miss you, man. I'm tired you wasn't here. I wanted you to be in this cypher, but listen, man, you're here in the spirit. Yeah. We love you.
Shout out to Dan.
He's bionic.
Right. He's getting a new arm.
My nigga had to get an oil change. That's all. That's all. He had to get his oil change. His fluids topped off. He'll be back better than ever with an exhaust pipe.
Big facts,
man. On his RoboCop. So my name is Baghdad Brook. Again, you can find me on Instagram at We The Element. And, we just find ways to keep being creative, man. My guys talked me into doing comedy skits.
Ooh.
They say I'm naturally funny, so I've been trying it out. Yeah. It's been getting some good reception. Just working on music. The album, once again, it's in the works. Sound Chefs presents Purple Element. And it sounds like what it is, man. We just cooking up a lot of different sounds. I rap, I write,
I love, I live, I drop knowledge, man, and I teach my kid. Nah, we stop, but yeah, it's all love, man.
He's ready for the show,
I'm
man.
I'm always ready. I'm always ready. I'm always ready. That, you know, I'm grateful for my boy for, you know, he set up the trip. He was like, yo, just pull up. So what I did, we came with music ready, we came with the vibes ready, we came ready to learn, came ready to teach, came ready to conquer. Yes, we laid down the foundation. Y'all gonna see us, man. We out here. Thanks for the love, fellas.
No doubt, no doubt. And follow me at, you know, y'all know the vibes. Maxwell _ Sensei, and also make sure you follow
Push
the
Up King. at Black Planet.
Push Up King. PK. Follow me at PK.
PK69 at blackplanet.com.
Yo, Black Planet.
Maxwell _ Sensei, and make sure you follow the Lobby Call podcast page on Instagram. Hey. It's at Lobby Call. And up there we post like different clips, different information. Should be having some merch very soon.
Ooh, that's saucy.
Yeah. I'm trying to think what else.
Y'all got merch coming? I need
some hoodies, a couple hats, mugs and shit. But yeah, that's been another episode of Lobby Call. That's a wrap.
Let's go roll this ganja ASAP.
Oh, yes, sir.